Hello and welcome from me, Mike Scott, in Oxford in the UK, and Kathryn Temple in Washington, DC. This is the sixth event in this new series, A Bent But Beautiful World, Literature, Art and the Environment, which is following on from the Christian Literary Imagination series and our earlier series, Christian Shakespeare Question Mark, which is now available in book form, published by Vernon Press. All three series are part of Georgetown University's Humanities Initiative in association with Campion Hall, Oxford, and the Las Casas Institute, Blackfriars Hall, Oxford. And we welcome also Father Joe Simmons, formerly at Campion Hall and now at Georgetown. In a moment, Professor Kathryn Temple will introduce today's speaker, Dr. Adrienne Ghaly. Your participation is as important as ever. So please type in any questions you have by using your Q&A key at the bottom of your screen. You can do this from the moment we begin the session. We will endeavor to answer your questions in discussion with Kathryn and with Joe towards the end of the event. Ensure, please, that you use the Q&A button. Please do not use the chat button. So I hope you have an enjoyable hour. Over to you, Kathryn.
Adrienne is a literary scholar specializing in the modern and contemporary British and Anglophone novel, environmental humanities, and the intersection of biodiversity loss and the cultural productions of everyday life, archives of extinction, and critical theory 20th to 21st centuries, and the uses of climate and migration fiction for public advocacy. Her first book project examines how 20th century late realist novels radically reimagine relations between human and the non-human world through micro-scale phenomena and multi-scalar thinking. The second book-length project identifies and illuminates processes of large-scale biodiversity loss enmeshed in cultural materials seemingly far from issues of species extinction. Her scholarship in both academic and public-facing forums is driven by the exploration of the novel and other cultural objects, literary, material, and visual, as access points to the apprehension and understanding of large-scale processes and complex relations. In 2022 to 2023, she's a Humanities Collaborative Practitioner Fellow at the Global Policy Center and a visiting scholar in the English Department at the University of Virginia. So we welcome Adrienne today, and at this point, I will turn it over to you, Adrienne.
Thank you very much, Kathryn, and thank you, Michael, Joe, for inviting me to speak with you today. I have some slides, and I'm going to screen share. I'm very happy to have been invited to speak in this series on art, literature, and environment. We can bring these three categories together in multiple ways. In this talk, I'm going to focus upon a paradoxical historical moment that we inhabit, of which we are only partially or perhaps fully unaware. We're in the midst of a precipitate decline on a global scale in biodiversity. In the coming decades, the IPBES estimates that humans will make extinct approximately 1 million species. This profound disturbance in the diversity and integrity of life forms is fundamentally transforming our shared evolutionary and cultural futures. While a rapidly warming planet has crested into all forms of discourse and is seen as a crisis urgently to be addressed, however problematic this is in practice, by contrast, the accelerating biodiversity crisis hasn't crossed the threshold to the same level of collective visibility, even though its implications are, in fact, even greater. If we ask ourselves what forces were in place to drive public recognition, collective conversations, and political will on climate in the last few years, they are powered in no small part through many individuals' felt experiences of the climate crisis. The knowledge of a warming planet has become accessible and consequently self-evident to a growing number of people as and through direct embodied experience of heat, flooding, wildfires, extreme storms, and drought. Quote, you see it, you feel it, the earth is getting hotter. Se ve, se siente, la tierra está caliente. The chant by those in Mexico City participating in the 2019 global climate strike distilled this alarming sensory access to global warming. While with the climate crisis, we are seeing the catastrophic conjunction of the epistemological and the phenomenological, the accelerating biodiversity crisis, it would appear, fails to be felt and apprehended widely in a similar way. The compound impact of widespread declines in biodiversity is poorly apprehended. We are not necessarily fully aware of where and how biodiversity loss touches us in our daily lives. So we're in a profoundly significant historical moment, but its import and impacts, at least initially or superficially, feel to so many minimal, at least in the short term. This then is our moment of paradox. If the processes that reified climate change in collective imaginations was many individuals feeling the effects of 1.2 degrees warming, the biodiversity crisis will crest in a similar way only when enough of non-human life ceases to exist. Only in catastrophic absence will this crisis become fully, terribly present. How can we become subjects of informed engagement without that happening, without mass extinction becoming embedded into widely felt experiences? How can art and literature address the felt effects of biodiversity and perhaps reorient us to certain kinds of feelings of environments to catalyze the understanding necessary to meet our historical moment? In the time I have today, I want to talk about the kinds of feelings I'm interested in, to which species they are connected, and the art and aesthetic expressions that could offer access points to the apprehension of biodiversity's disintegration on a large scale. There are intimations of the scale of the crisis in certain kinds of feelings that some people are expressing about their environments, feelings that are often inchoate, partial apprehensions, distinctive intuitions of deep shifts in the non-human world, even if the implications of these feelings are not fully grasped. Now, as a scholar of modern and contemporary literature and culture, some of my work focuses on the novel as the first expressive mode that created and privileged immersive experiences of secular, everyday environments through what people who study the novel call world building, and the portrayal of characters' embodied feelings, their connections and relations to their everyday environments. Now, this is not to say that immersive experiences do not obtain in other genres or texts or outside the secular domain, simply that dominant strands of the novel tradition took the establishment of an immersive environment as a core aesthetic impulse. I'm interested in the possibilities of this immersive quality and where it migrates into media that are experimenting with immersive environments now, what I call post-novelistic media. For our purposes here, I think immersive environments can offer important points of access to apprehension and understanding of large-scale processes of the Anthropocene. But first, I want to bring greater clarity to the kinds of feelings about which I'm speaking and the species to which they are intimately connected before turning in the last section of my talk to the possibilities of immersive art. Now, in addressing feelings of biodiversity loss, when I speak of a partial failure of apprehension or ability to feel, immediately the question arises, which communities and collectivities are implied here? Of whom are we speaking when we address the problem of some form of experiential access to species dying off? Of course, this differs across cultures, across subjectivities, and across taxa. There are populations and communities who are directly experiencing the great diminishment of certain species because their ways of living and their historical relationships to specific ecosystems have given rise to particular kinds of multi-species proximity. I'm speaking today primarily of those populations who spend close to 95% of their lives indoors, those globally who are the core subjects and who sustain and replicate cultures and logics of late modernity and capitalism, those who en masse are many of the principal agents implicated in the extinction crisis, yet for whom the collective and widely dispersed destruction of non-human life remains, it would seem, pervasively invisible and culturally quarantined to the zoo, the nature documentary, and the iconic species on the side of a reusable bag. A decade ago, the cultural geographer Kathryn Temple observed that humanity is just now noticing the extinction it has chosen to continually overlook in the making of its modernity and freedom. Though there is general awareness and, of course, some alarm of plummeting numbers of rhinos or cod, and you can see here that this is a poster from the World Wildlife Foundation of an iconic species, the rhino, and the caption is "Extinction can't be fixed." I'm speaking about mass decline, the drastic reduction of many species as a result of the loss of biosphere integrity and the life forms of which it is composed, rather than a focus on any single iconic species. This mass decline is taking place most worryingly across many very small fauna. The gap between what is happening to the non-human world and much of the experiences of that world can be seen in the language of a study from last year from University College London's Research Center for Biodiversity and the Environment. The authors warn that through habitat loss, agricultural practices, and climate change, the planet may be in the midst of a catastrophic, but quote unquote, hidden collapse of insect species. While tigers and rhinos, frogs and cod dominate cultural imaginaries of extinction, invertebrate species such as insects are those at greatest risk. So much depends on the species that the American biologist E.O. Wilson called, quote, the little things that run the world, unquote, because they are at the bottom of the food chain. They are fed on by many other species, birds, bats, amphibians, fish. Flowering plants rely on pollinators for their reproduction, and we, in turn, for the food they produce. Here is a vision of our unevenly realized present and near futures happening now in northwest China, in the country's pear capital, where humans hand pollinate the fruit trees because due to years of heavy pesticide use, their pollinating insects are all gone. Attempts not only to communicate what is happening, but to recruit audiences into a certain kind of responsiveness are often deeply problematic, marshaling discourses that normalize the destruction of non-human life through narratives of human resilience in the midst of self-inflicted environmental odds. And here, this woman is holding it's sort of like a feather duster or a Swiffer, and they use that to pollinate the plants. And so they Swiffer or sort of feather dust one set of stamens, and then they move on to the next one. And that's how they're pollinating the pear trees. This photograph, when it appeared in the US media a few years ago, was framed as an admirable example of human ingenuity. While expressions of human triumphalism accompanied this image, more familiar are the narratives that engage anthropogenic extinction through the frayed inheritances of romanticism in its multiple elegiac and lyric modes. A simultaneous critique of available literary genres and modes to address extinction and a sense of how inescapable these genres are is voiced by the speaker in the recent poem by contemporary Korean-American poet Sun Young Shin, quote, I wandered into a mass extinction event before I knew what was happening. I wrote obituary after homage, after ode, after elegy for every species larger than my thumb. And then she goes on, the flora and fauna care or are nothing for the world of letters. The C is in brackets, unquote. There's an unmistakable echo here of the opening line of perhaps the most famous nature poem in the Western tradition, I wandered lonely as a cloud. Shin takes direct aim at the history of nature poetry and the aesthetics of loss, the inevitable elegiac mode of so many cultural and aesthetic responses to species extinctions is critiqued as deeply myopic. It excludes millions of microscale species from our affective attachments and acts of memorialization enacted by the ode and the lyric, forms that traditionally have addressed the natural world. And in any event, the speaker reminds us that these species that escape our notice care nothing for our cultural hierarchies of value, that omit organisms smaller than a human thumb from consideration and aesthetic representation. Yet it is in fact through such very small fauna that many people can most readily access feelings of the coming extinction crisis. And where they are apprehending a profound shift in biodiversity, it is here and at this scale that I want to focus our attention. In November 2018, the New York Times Magazine published as its cover article a piece by science journalist Brooke Jarvis entitled "The Insect Apocalypse is Here." It begins with a Danish high school teacher trying to collect insects in a large net strapped to the top of his car. Jarvis writes that the teacher is one example of many people who have started to have a, quote, loose suspicion of wrongness, unquote, about their environments. Areas such as backyards, streetlights, canals, quote, have become unfamiliarly empty, unquote. Startling numbers follow of rapid declines in flying insect biomass and the stories of those who are documenting it. For many, childhood insects are their most frequent encounter with, quote unquote, wild non-human life. Yet very small fauna can pose a scalar challenge to most human percipients. Insects frequently fall below much direct human apprehension. They become a significant presence in themselves in the human sensory field as a disturbance, such as a swarm, or when a single member of a species is out of place, such as a spider indoors. You may have heard of the Krefeld study, a group of amateur German entomologists, the longitudinal study based on their multi-decade archive brought to the broader notice of scientists crashing insect populations in areas designated as protected. And the thing that was most alarming to scientists was the fact that they were studying flying insect biomass in nature preserves. And so these were areas that were set aside for animals and insects to be thriving, but this was where the population crashes were being documented. So here's Jarvis, quote, because insects are legion, inconspicuous, and hard to meaningfully track, the fear that there might be far fewer than before was more felt than documented. People noticed it by canals, or in backyards, or under streetlights at night, familiar places that had become unfamiliarly empty. The feeling was so common that entomologists developed a shorthand for it, named for the way many people first began to notice that they weren't seeing as many bugs. They called it the windshield phenomenon, unquote. And some of you may be old enough to remember having to clean your windshield of bugs when you stopped for gas. I'm just about old enough to have remembered that. And that we still, in the United States anyway, have squeegees and buckets, right, of cleaner that are next to the gas pumps that are sort of this relic, these relics of a different time, right, that practically nobody uses unless their car is muddy, but they're not used for their original purpose. The people in Jarvis's story are sharing a feeling of wrongness. They're noticing a different inflection in the textures of the reality they share with and which is composed of non-human life, registering as vague suspicions. These feelings, difficult to graspness, what exactly is wrong here, is one of their key qualities, as is the dawning realization that finally and often only partially accompanies what this feeling augurs. So what is collapsing is often felt, but not always really seen. The changing environments felt here are comprised of multiple factors on multiple levels. Consider not only the sounds and sights of the buzzing of bees or mosquitoes, the presence or absence of night pollinators, such as moths clustering around a light source, but depending on where you live, the presence of the species that eat them, manifest as birdsong, the fluttering of bats at dusk, the chorus of frogs. I think these kinds of feelings that are tenuous and partial, that often barely rise in their vagueness beyond an intuition are profoundly important, for they attend the shifts of those given elements of the world we inhabit, though there are substantial differences between us in that inhabiting, that for humans in different contexts are more than ambient environments. They comprise a commonly held sense of a stable surround. Emergent sensations of wrongness are being felt by many as a disturbance in the fabric of their felt environments and constitute a major shift in the taken for granted aspects of the sensory and proprioceptive fields, the things at the side that are just there. These peripheral apprehensions of changes and shifts in a stable surround, these only partially apprehended perceptions, are registering much larger structural changes in ecosystems, what Elizabeth Colbert poignantly described as, quote, the texture of life changing, unquote. It is through these kinds of feelings that biodiversity collapse is in fact being registered in a way that is globally experienced, widely held, and non-systematic. Insects then are a special case of the biodiversity crisis for several important reasons. These peripheral apprehensions of changes and shifts in environments, these only partially apprehended perceptions, are registering much larger structural changes at a planetary scale. It is through these very small fauna and the species to which they are connected in complex webs of ecosystems that many people can encounter biodiversity loss as embodied sensations, a lived experience as it is happening across different locations and across time. People are widely accessing feelings of mass, slow violence on very small fauna, but these experiences are not fully available or transparent to them, or perhaps only comparatively for some across decades. Such feelings connect very small embodied sensations of environments that emerge from the presence and absence of insect life to large-scale biodiversity declines. And it's a narrative shift too, from this is what is happening. For example, there are fewer than 1% of historical monarch populations in the American West, to this is what this happening feels like. Available terms fall so radically short of what this change in many very small fauna really means. Biodiversity loss, though I've been using it throughout this talk, is a phrase that is so inadequate. Loss, as if millions of species have been misplaced, or a condolence exercise offered to others. I'm so sorry for your loss. Much better than biodiversity loss, or even extinction, with its evocation of animals like the dodo and passenger pigeon that fade into an almost mythic past, is the Belgian philosopher of science, Vanciane Desprez's evocative phrase, which is closer to capturing what is at stake. She writes that when species go extinct, part of reality collapses. Now, she's speaking of losing other species' ways of being in and sensing and experiencing the world, that their disappearance from the world alters that world, and not just from a human perspective. She's attempting to account for a phenomenology of non-human life. But the anthropocentric version of this phrase, part of reality collapses, does important work. A vernacular sense of reality is of an everyday experience that has built into its multiplicity, so many people going about their business, a regularity, an expectedness of the repetition, with minor shifts, of course, of certain acts and encounters, a cyclical quality that does not fundamentally alter one's expectation of what will be found there. One's reality, one's everyday reality, is so often not at the forefront of our attention because of its very givenness. What we must get to grips with is that the given world is unraveling. The non-human world is no longer the given. Now, this is the point where many environmental humanities conversations would turn to what aesthetic expressions could possibly meet the task of adequately portraying the crisis. What genre, what form can represent it? I've dwelt on vague, fleeting, and only partially apprehended feelings of shifts in environments for two reasons. First, because mass biodiversity decline is fundamentally an iconic. There is no image that can represent it. And second, I think what is more important than the creation of crisis imaginaries, though these are important, is imaginaries of possibility, to envision transitions to different futures and what will be required to bring them into being. I want to show you two immersive art installations, Anthony Gormley's Mist Room, Blind Light 1 and 2 from 2006-07 at the Hayward Gallery in London, and Olafur Eliasson's The Weather Project from 2003-04 at Tate Modern. Immersive art envelops the viewer in a palpable environment. In Gormley's words, quote, you become the immersed figure in an endless ground, literally the subject of the work. The referent of that last phrase is helpfully vague. Is it the you or the endless ground that is the subject of the work? Of course, it's their interplay. These works not only attempt to capture and recreate in a museum or gallery space the enveloping experiences of distinct natural phenomena, being in a fog or the mist of a captured cloud in Gormley's work, and in a moment we'll see Eliasson's, which is a sunset, they also reorient the participants to that surround as virtually totalizing. In each work, participants are immersed in and oriented by an enveloping but quite insubstantial medium, a specific kind of light or water vapor. It's a reset of attentiveness by concentrating and foregrounding often background elements of light, temperature, and humidity. Gormley described his room-sized glass tank full of shimmering mist, composed of fluorescent light, toughened low iron glass, ultrasonic humidifiers, aluminum and water diffused by a vibrating plate, is about, quote, vertigo and disorientation, and also a bit of euphoria, unquote. His Mist Room attempts to bring environmental phenomena inside and make them into concentrated shared experiences of 25 people being in a cloud together. The Icelandic Danish artist Olafur Eliasson created in the Weather Project a sunset indoors in the Turbine Hall at Tate Modern. To achieve the effect of the sun indoors, he used mirrors, light, and mist. Eliasson said he recreated the sun in response, in part, to people talking about the weather and global warming. But this work, and Gormley's too, doesn't have the overt urgency of impending crisis. In fact, quite the opposite. They are pleasurable, even fun, and fairly apolitical. But Eliasson's and Gormley's installations captured the public's imagination. Images and reviews index the evident delight that museum goers took in these experiences of collective immersion and reorientation to being a figure in an enveloping surround. In Eliasson's images, people lie on the floor together. They gather and gaze over the railing at others having the same experience. In reviews of Gormley's piece, critics wrote of how audiences emerged disoriented and visibly transformed. I think feelings of immersive ambient environments composed of very small non-human species can be easily reproduced, and to particular ends. Immersive art can compress, intensify, and reorient viewers to the worlds we are enveloped in by being reminded of that enveloping. Eliasson and his collaborator Kumi Naido offer this nuanced account of the different speeds of art and a more instrumental activism. Quote, art and activism, our fields of work and expertise, can heighten attention to and perception of situations that may have been invisible, overlooked, or neglected. They often run at different speeds. Activism typically has a clear direction and is oriented toward effecting fast systemic changes, while art is slower, offering complex spaces of wonder, questioning, and reflection, individually and collectively, unquote. But perhaps in the possibilities of immersive art for this particular urgent problem, the two can coincide, run at the same speed. If we recognize how swiftly we must reform ways of living and new ways of thinking. Crucial to this is the pursuit of the future realities we desire, we want to inhabit, and then commit to making. If only what could be brought to our collective attention is everything we are surrounded by that is still within our lived experiences. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that. That it was just really, and for me, kind of an intense experience to listen to your paper. I have so many overlapping interests and overlapping concerns. And my brother has just finished drafting maybe his sixth book. A lot of it is about the grief and depression he's experienced as an environmental biologist, as he has become extremely aware of the lack of biodiversity and the decrease in biodiversity. He pretty much lives outdoors in northern Mexico at this point, and he sees it firsthand every day. So I guess my first question to you is, there's a difference between the affect that you're talking about, these kind of subliminal intensities that haven't come to full awareness, and the emotions that you experience once they become once you become aware of them, and also once they're kind of shaped by the culture, right? So those of you in the position of studying this on a daily basis are experiencing this in a much fuller sense than those of us who basically live our lives inside, right? So I just wondered if you could talk about that experience a little bit and how you manage that, or how the people that you know who are experiencing this manage it.
Yeah, it's a really good question. And I think that, you know, my students are the ones who might be the best example to offer, which is that they come into classes on that I teach on extinction in and through literature and culture. And some of them might have heard of the idea that we might be in the sixth mass extinction. Mm-hmm. And I will just bracket that, I'll qualify that a little bit by saying that, you know, a mass extinction is technically 75% of life on Earth dying out. And that 1 million species that are projected to go extinct in the next, you know, 2 to 3 decades, that's not reaching the threshold of a mass extinction. But I think that using the term mass extinction is very helpful culturally to mm-hmm. communicate the level of the scale. And I also think that a million species is, that is mass, right? Even if that's not the technical definition. So they may be aware that this is sort of this thing that's sort of hovering in the background. You know, they may be aware of maybe Elizabeth Colbert's book, but once you kind of describe to them their lived experience and what it is there, what I'm sort of trying to do is say to them, you are actually experiencing this. You don't have to be a biologist studying the butterfly migrations. You don't have to become an oceanographer to go see the coral reefs. It's actually everywhere in your life. You just have to sort of tune into where it's touching your everyday life. Mm-hmm. And one of the ways that I do that is talk to them about the drivers, right? So pesticide use, light pollution, habitat loss. And I use the university as a kind of living laboratory for them to see that, because at UVA and in many university campuses, the aesthetic is actually one that's profoundly hostile to biodiversity. So at UVA, we have the lawn, right? Mm-hmm. And the lawn and the rotunda in this academical community. And there are, you know, you send students out there, you see, so name how many species you come into contact with. And it's usually one type of squirrel, one type of tree, and grass, right? And so why are we living in this sort of 18th century aesthetic that has produced this incredibly violent response through pesticides and, you know, pulling up all the weeds and glyphosate and really intense lighting? What is it that we are doing in living in that sort of aesthetic environment to reproduce a vision of what we think a university should look like that is then, you know, essentially killing all of this non-human life in order to achieve that aesthetic? Mm-hmm. And so, which is to say that, to come around to your point of feelings, I think one of the things that I'm grappling with is I'm trying to explain to students that actually extinction feels really good. And mm-hmm. I say that in a perverse way, because it feels good because the thing that you associate with that lawn is beauty and cultural capital. The thing that you associate with the lighting is safety. And we have these illuminations on the lawn, right? The lawn is so beautiful when we illuminate it so intensively. Mm-hmm. And so when you go out into the world, it's not simply that you might take my class and you feel horrified, right? You all of a sudden have this sort of moment of realization. And you feel, students often feel very depressed about it, but actually what I want them to do is connect their feelings, their positive feelings, their positive affective relationships to things in their immediate environment that they think feel really good and are aesthetically pleasing and are enjoyable. And that those are the things, those are the feelings that they should interrogate. Not necessarily, I want them to have that moment of realization, like this is really bad. But I want them to think about the things that they enjoy, find pleasurable, and that they find aesthetic value in, and interrogate what the relationship to non-human life, right, is in that, with that feeling. So what I'm saying is I'm sort of turning your question a little bit over mm-hmm. on its head, is that I want them to look at what they find pleasurable and then question whether that is part of this picture, which often it is.
No, I was actually thinking about that in terms of the ways we work so hard to keep insects at a distance.
Yeah.
Right. And that makes us feel safe and clean. Yeah. Right. Yeah. And I was wondering how that played into this sort of world that you're helping us imagine, where that might not be such a good idea.
Yeah, I think, my heart sinks every time I see Mosquito Buster's van on our street. Mm. People want to be in the backyard if they're privileged enough to have a backyard, and they want to do that free of being bitten by insects. But of course, everything else that lives in your yard eats those insects. So you're creating a sort of a biodiversity desert in order to feel comfortable at your barbecue, right?
Yeah.
So, that sounds as though it's simply, suburban America that's at fault here. I mean, I would also say that there are all kinds of ways where something like mosquitoes, right, are carriers, they are vectors of very dangerous diseases for humans. And so the attempt to genetically modify mosquito populations so that they cannot reproduce in order to save people from malaria, from Zika virus, right? From things that are pathogens that are hugely harmful to human life. You also have to take that into consideration. It's not just about people sort of hanging out in their backyard playing Frisbee. It has real consequences. Do you value a human life or contracting, potentially contracting malaria? How do you deal with that when in fact you know that actually the frogs and the lizards and the birds need to eat that mosquito that's also a vector for a human, pathogen? So.
Yeah,
it's complicated, right? It's not
a really difficult problem. You're making me think about Italy, where malaria was still a huge problem until really the early 20th century. And then they drained swamps and used poisons, et cetera. But the last time I was there, which was in September, I realized I don't think I saw a single living thing except for a pet dogs in Bologna over a period of 4 weeks. Right. Birds, I missed.
No birds.
Right.
Not even pigeons, not even undesirable birds.
I really don't think I might have seen a few pigeons, but I really started looking and it was just notable. So we do have a question from the audience from Adrienne Vaginas. I'm not sure I'm pronouncing that correctly. How does this message of biodiversity loss move beyond academia and elite sites of culture like museums and literature and higher ed? And I think that's really the question you're trying to address. So maybe you could talk about that a little.
It's really a good question. And so I'm thinking about all kinds of ways to access biodiversity loss. And I'm thinking about different kinds of media, and much of that, the question really is access, right? That you, whenever you choose some sort of medium, or some sort of communication, vector of communication, how do you get that message across? And one of the things I've been experimenting with is virtual reality. I was in above the Arctic Circle this past summer with a group of researchers thinking about changing cultural imaginaries of the Arctic. And of course, it's the part of the planet that has so captured cultural imaginations around biodiversity loss because of polar bear. And so I was experimenting with 360 capture for virtual reality that easily feeds to YouTube, and that people can kind of experience these ecosystems at a distance through something like YouTube. You just need an internet connection. But there's also, I think, a real problem in how a lot of virtual reality is being used, which is that it allows you to sort of see a glacier melting, or to sort of see a landscape in Greenland, or to show you a wildfire, right? There are all these VR experiences that are trying to show you sort of how bad it is. And so I think that one of the great challenges is that crisis imaginaries, or kind of catastrophe imaginaries, are quite readily available to many people beyond academia, beyond museums and literature and higher ed. You know, you can access them through YouTube or through movies, through visual culture. But I actually think that the idea that we need to sort of build imaginaries, kind of cultural imaginaries or images. When I say cultural imaginaries, I'm just saying the storehouse of images and stories that we can draw upon that we use to make sense of our experiences, right? That we need to find ways to communicate the kinds of worlds we want to live in are ones where biodiversity thrives. So museums are one access point. Now, yes, they are elite sites of culture, but at least in the United States, I would say that some of the kind of great museums, you know, they're trying really hard to do better outreach, more and less successfully. But it's one point where people can, for free, go and access some kinds of content about the biodiversity crisis. And I think that it is important to have these sort of concentrated sites where people can come and experience things collectively. So you do need it oftentimes an institution to sort of allow for that collective experience to happen. But you also need lots of people in communities just talking to each other. You don't necessarily have to go to the museum. You can read about it and you can talk to people about it. And one of the great challenges, I think, for communicators is that they're struggling to find the kinds of messages that people want to tell others. And actually, stories of catastrophe are not necessarily those that are socially acceptable, right? You bring up climate change at a cocktail party, right? Conversation dies. Mm-hmm. Or even with your friends, it's not considered socially appropriate. So how do we kind of turn that around and think about the worlds we want to inhabit, the things that we don't want to see disappear from the world, and then envision what that thriving actually looks like? And that really is an issue for infrastructure, for municipalities, for communities, for local governments, right? It's not really taking place. It doesn't need to take place in those museums. They might just be points where those conversations can coalesce around a shared experience. But ideally, you want these to be conversations between people. And that is kind of what, you know, mass cultural experiences do well, right? They go viral, people talk about them. That's sort of why I cottoned on to these two immersive experiences, because a lot of people didn't actually go to see them, but they read about them, right, mm-hmm. on the internet or whatever. And so there was this sense of kind of collective buzz around them. And so I was thinking about why that might be useful in this context.
Yeah, when you were speaking, I was thinking about, you know, how social media spreads certain messages, usually not the ones I particularly want to see spread very rapidly in this viral sense. And then I was thinking about these, like the Van Gogh immersive experience that went through Washington, and so many people went to, and I just was encountering it social media everywhere, you know, and wondering, you know, how to make these other messages similarly attractive. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, they have to offer something that is entertaining and is comfortable enough, and yet still introduces this concept, right? For the same reasons that people don't want to talk about loss of biodiversity at a cocktail party when they're no doubt spraying mosquito repellent in the backyard. You know, they don't necessarily want to read that on their social media account. So I'm not quite sure how to do that, but I wondered if you had thought about that.
Yeah, I think that's why my idea for the immersive art as something that could actually show a sort of thriving environment for very small fauna is something that it's something the aesthetic can do well, right? It brings you pleasure and beauty. Yeah. And why not think about those categories as utterly appropriate for biodiversity loss, right? That imagine that you could create, let me just say that this is already happening with very small fauna, but with sort of charismatic very small fauna. So fireflies, for instance. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you saw during the pandemic, but people in all over the world, because fireflies are in many different ecosystems and they are both in urban and rural settings, fireflies are a kind of common denominator of a kind of charismatic insect. We might call sort of charismatic microfauna. That you could, because people were not supposed to be gathering in groups, even outside at the beginning stages of the pandemic, they were live streaming the firefly experiences from different national parks in the United States. Mm-hmm. But they were really, really underwhelming, because once you digitize the fireflies, what you're seeing are sort of like a collection of three little green dots mm-hmm. on your screen, right? So you have a sort of image of a dark forest. And then you just see what look like digitally generated green dots, because the pixelation of something so small ends up rendering it digital, like in its entirety. It doesn't actually look like a non-digital thing that you're seeing an image of. It looks like a digital object, like just little pixels. And so I was thinking about why certain digital formats are really failing mm-hmm. at the scale at which we need some kind of collective aesthetic experience of very small fauna that we value, right? So, you know, I could imagine firefly rooms as a possible aesthetic experience in a museum.
Like a butterfly garden.
Like a butterfly, but sure. I mean, they already exist as butterfly rooms, right? We already, but there has to be a kind of quite, you know, straightforward didactic element to that, to sort of explain what it is that's making them not signal to each other anymore, which is excessive light or, you know, pesticide use or destroying the habitats that they thrive in.
Can I ask a question of you, Adrienne?
Yeah.
I was thinking in line of what we were just talking about, social media and university campuses and having kind of an over-curated landscape feel. And oftentimes you see on social media, when someone seems to be having a bit of a meltdown, people will respond by saying, touch grass, as in go outside, put your computer away, put your phone down, and just go out. Would you say that's another solution? I mean, one of them would be go see an exhibit at the Tate Modern, for example, but to get out in the countryside, is there a place for that, do you think? Or is that sort of further colonizing of spaces where humans, you know, are trampling and taking over environments? What do you think?
Yeah, I think it's, you know, obviously people should be spending more time outdoors. I think you can't have encounters with the non-human world unless you actually go outdoors. I'm not against that. But I think that a lot of wonderful critics and cultural theorists have really broken down the concept of nature, right? That nature is no longer helpful to us as a concept. And so the idea that we sort of go to nature, or that we go out of our sort of immediate environments in order to have a kind of really great experience of nature, I think that's the kind of thinking that I would like people to really interrogate. Because if you go to a natural place to have your experience of the natural world, that implies that it's not immediately around you just as you walk out the door, no matter where you live. So you can live in the middle of Chicago, right? And there are still insects there. There are birds. There are even invasive species, right, that have been brought there by others. People tend little plots. Weeds grow on the side of the road. And so it's to sort of understand that humans and the kind of, there is no over there anymore. So to kind of, yes, you want people to sort of understand that the natural world is incredibly important, but that the natural world is not separate from the human world at all. And I think that one of the ways that you can think about that is simply just how pervasive, right, the human footprint is in all aspects of our life. If they're finding microplastics at the bottom of the deepest trenches of the sea and at the top of Mount Everest, right, then there is no away from human impact. So what I would sort of, you know, love people to think about is literally just what's right outside their door, whatever that is, whatever that environment is, and not to see that as not nature. But then, okay, so then, like, what is then the corresponding question is, what is your kind of ethical responsibility to that place? What is your emotional connection to that place? What are the aesthetic responses you might have, or negative ones, and kind of where do those come from? What idea of an experience of nature have you been brought up with and that culture has offered you that is no longer viable for the kinds of work we have to do?
So we have another question from Michael Collins here at Georgetown. Can any impact be made on big oil, for instance, or loggers in Brazil who were until recently supported by the government through on those big polluters that are driving some of this loss of biodiversity?
Yeah, it's such a huge question. I don't have a good answer for it, but what I will say is that the climate strikes, the global climate strikes, and the fact that people have started to agitate really quite vocally to their elected representatives about climate, just in the last 5 to 6 years in the United States, especially, has really brought about significant legislation. Mm-hmm. And I would say that the question really is how to bring about a similar level of public awareness that will bring pressure on elected officials for the kinds of infrastructural changes that would significantly affect biodiversity. And that's, I don't have a good answer to that question, but I will say that it goes back to this idea that I'm trying to foreground, that the reason that the global climate strikes took on such power and became such a political force, even though actually, relatively speaking, it was a very small number of people participating, right? The percentages of people, very small, in any particular locale where it was happening, is that they were feeling climate. They were feeling climate in their everyday lives. They could feel its effects. And what we don't want is for people to get to the point with biodiversity where they have to really feel its effects before they become politically engaged, because by that point it will be too late. And you can geoengineer climate to some extent. Whether or not we should do that is a huge ethical question. But you cannot geoengineer back biodiversity. The webs of life are too complex. So there's no going back, despite some of these marquee initiatives like George Church at Harvard, who's going to try and de-extinct a woolly mammoth and things like that. I think that those sorts of the CRISPR technology is offering a kind of fantasy of a techno future where we might be able to reverse extinction, but it's actually the complex webs of ecosystems, not the de-extinction of any particular species, that we need to be concerned about. And so the real paradox that I'm trying to unfold for us is that if you feel the effects of the climate, and that is your impetus to political action and the impetus to political will on the point of elected officials, on the part of elected officials, how do you marshal that before it actually manifests in the world with biodiversity? And that's the real question. Like, who is going to try to make that political will a reality by offering certain kinds of experiences that will communicate to people the level of the crisis? So it's like, you can see why the climate crisis has all of a sudden galvanized political will, certainly in the US. Mm-hmm. But you can't wait for that feeling of everyday life, right, to feel the biodiversity loss. So I don't have a good answer for Michael. I will just say that that's kind of the root question of this project, is how do you get the right affective relationship? And it sounds absurd, like that we should have the right feelings in order for political action to happen, but that's actually, that is how it happens, right? That you have the right feelings. So, you know, how do you make that happen?
Yeah. Having the right feelings about justice, having the right feelings about ethics, you know, those are the things that drive our decisions. So I think you're so on target there. Just, I guess, one last question I'll get in here, and maybe something to think about is, you talked about, I think you mentioned the phrase post-novel or
The post-novelistic, yeah.
Post-novelistic, and I actually was so thrilled to see Robinson Crusoe pop up on your screen.
Yeah.
You really think the novel and fiction has no role in creating a different future?
No, not at all. In fact, my project at the moment is working with the United Nations on using fiction on climate-induced humanitarian crisis to increase public advocacy on humanitarian crisis. No, it's not. So post-novelistic, not in the sense that we are beyond the novel, but simply that the novel's way of representing an immersive environment as part of its sort of cultural task has gone into other media, right? We have other media that is trying to do that, but they are the inheritors of the novel's relationship to that sense of immersion as a valuable aesthetic experience.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was thinking about the novel and a very direct pragmatic connection between the novel and film, for instance, mm-hmm. or the novel and TV series. And then I was thinking about, you know, some recent work on characterization in the novel and the shift from the idea of individuation to the idea of networks of characters, mm-hmm. networks of relationships. It seems to, you know, that would seem to play very much into what we need to see represented is the network of the human and what we've seen as separate nature. So yeah. Oh, I just see that Mike Scott is back with us. So that's kind of our signal to draw things to a close and give him the opportunity to talk about the series for a minute.
Thank you very much. I appreciate all your questions.
Thank you. It's just been wonderful to hear this. And I'm going to take it away with me and think very hard about it and also communicate with my brother about it because I know he'd be interested in being in touch with you. So I'll turn it over to Mike.
Well, thank you. It's been a really marvelous talk. I've loved every minute of it. And just certain things that struck me. One of the things about the human condition is fear. And when we're frightened of something, there's a kind of a means of trying to get rid of it. If we can get away from the fear that children have about insects. And I have to say that I've got two grandchildren at a very forward-looking school in Wales, and they know the names of more insects than I knew even existed, because right from the beginning, they've been at that school and they have got, you know, insect hives and insect nests and so on. All around the school, and they just, when I go out on a walk, they'll tell me what that is and what the other is. And if we could just get more people involved at a very early stage, so that they haven't got fear about it, you know, fear isn't just about insects. The fear is about, can be about other people, and that's what happens when we get into wars.
And, I love
and
that
the biggest
you're
sure. and the biggest threat to biodiversity, still the same thing. It's fear.
I love that your grandchildren are going to a school like that. That's just phenomenal.
They've won loads of prizes. They've just got back from Costa Rica, and because that's where they go on holiday and looking at the insects. I've had pictures coming in about the insects they found in Costa Rica. It's fascinating. It's fascinating. So anyway, I'm sure they're going to have a look at this recording when it's on. I'll make sure that they do at least. Mum and Dad, it's been terrific. So thank you, Adrienne, very very much, and thank you, Kathryn and Joe, for bringing the questions through. Our next event in this series is next Tuesday, 31st of January, with Nathan Hensley, who's going to be talking about J.M.W. Turner's Burning World. There's another Zoom tomorrow, of which you might be very, very interested to note. It's in the Free Speech Project at the Crossroads International Dialogues event in association with the Future of Humanities Project, where we'll be discussing aspects of climate change with four wonderful people, two from the United States and two from the UK. And they're talking about things you might not have considered before and might be very relevant to what we've been hearing today. So if you want to join that, get in touch with John McCabe at Georgetown. He's on jm3479@georgetown.edu. That's jm3479@georgetown.edu. and enroll to come in on that debate tomorrow. And it is a debate about climate change or our reactions to climate change. It's at 4 p.m. UK time, which I think, correct me if I'm wrong, Kathryn, I think is 11 a.m. US time. So, and it goes to 5:15. So don't miss that. It's kind of like a part two to this, which is just advantageous. We didn't plan it, but it's happened like that, which is great. For today, I'd like to thank those at Georgetown University who make all these events happen, especially our administrators, Julia Murillo and Mary Gordon, who work to make the Zoom presentations possible. Of course, thanks to Kathryn Temple, to Mike Collins, and to Joe Simmons, who with me have developed this new series that we have. Our thanks to Jack DeJoy, the president, and Tom Banchoff, vice president, global affairs. At Campion Hall, to Nick Austin, the master of Campion Hall, Joe Simmons, who's both Campion Hall and Georgetown, Ying Ying, our administrator there, and at Blackfriars, Richard Finn, the director of the Las Casas Institute, John O'Connor, the regent. And thanks also to Maggie Scott, my wife, who helps me so much on the administration of these series. Don't forget to join us for our next free speech session, which is tomorrow, and for our next session in this series, which is on Tuesday, the 31st of January. In the meantime, Adrienne, many, many thanks again. And to you, Kathryn, many thanks. It's been an absolute delight sitting here just listening to what you've been saying. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I'm Mike Scott. Please follow me on Twitter @MikeScottProf. Thank you and goodbye.